Today's teardown is being assisted by Night Owl Le Chop Stout from Le Chop Brasserie in Winnipeg, Manitoba. There's no tasting notes on the can, but I've had this one before and it is a nice roasty, malty tasting stout. So today's teardown victim is in this odd-shaped little case. Fairly slick-looking unit, actually. This was a curb find, and the bit of research that I've done on it tells me exactly why I found it on the curb. It is a video streaming device that has a neat trick up its sleeve.
So what SlingBox is, or was, is a video streaming device that allowed you to take video in your house from any video source, either an HDMI or analog video, and stream it to you wherever you are. It's a one-to-one stream, but you could, if you were on vacation or something in another country, you could stream your cable box and watch your local hockey team or local sports team or whatever, local news, that kind of stuff. The version that we have is, in fact, a SlingBox 500, which was the last version of the hardware that they made before it got shut down. Apparently, the company got bought out, and then the company that bought them shut them down not that long afterwards. And they're tersely answering that they're not going to release anymore. They're not going to do anything about it in the future. It's just gone dead, done.
So connections on the back. We have a power reset, 3.5 millimeter, which is labeled infrared, a USB network connection, HDMI in, which is unusual on a video streaming device, HDMI out, and a series of video and audio connections, composite, right and left audio, and for more HD, analog video, YPB and PR. And you will notice that the in is color-coded with these guys, and the out is color-coded with these guys. My entire intention with this thing is to take it apart and see what's inside it. Because what other good uses can I put to a piece of dead hardware that I found on the side of the road? So there are no screws on the thing, but it does have these rubber feet, which I'm going to guess are hiding screws. Yeah, there is a little Phillips screw there. Okay, so peel those guys off and open it up and see what I can find. All right, now what happens? Does that just pry off? That would be cool if it did. Or, oh, does that bottom panel come up maybe? Oh, you sneaky bastards. Oh, I bet there's another one over here somewhere too, then, isn't there? Yeah, right there. Wow, they really didn't want you to get into this thing. Now, obviously, since this is old and obsolete, I'm not going to put it back together, but looks like it was never intended to come apart after it came out of the factory. Another strike against it. There. Ooh. So let's get a look down inside this guy. Immediately I notice that it does have a little fan, which is obviously going to get salvaged. Over here, that looks, yeah, that's the Wi-Fi module, but it looks like it's on an M.2. type form factor. I'm relatively sure that's an M.2 form factor connector, isn't it? Correct me if I'm wrong. But that's kind of cool. Made by Antel Communications. There's all your standards compliant stuff. Nifty. Well, that should be fun, if nothing else. Wonder if I can salvage those two antennas and that guy and put it to some use. Then we have, like I said, this little fan on top of the main processor. We'll take a look down there in a bit. What else we got going on here that looks interesting? Looks like over on this side near the power connector, obviously, we have what looks like a power section, or some larger capacitors, a few inductors. So I'm guessing that it's doing some DC to DC conversions to get a few different voltages from that 12 volts coming in. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4 crystal oscillators on this board, giving local references to, I'm guessing, to that chip. That guy, what's close to him that could use it? One of those two, probably. I'll have to look closer at them later. This one down there is presumably for the main processor, and this one up here for this analog devices chip, I'm guessing. And then up front, we have this little board with a bunch of LEDs on it, including an infrared receiver for the remote control. And apparently this thing had an IR blaster to control cable TV boxes, satellite receivers and stuff. So I'm thinking that that, in addition to that IR port on the back, is what that is. Then there's this interesting little... Ooh, it moves. What are you? Huh, that's just a series of light pipes in the shape of a logo, I guess. And underneath it, there is a set of surface mount LEDs that provide it light. Time to go deeper and see what's on the other side of the board. Also, will let us release the mount for the fan on the main processor so we can actually get at it and see what it is. And there's two more hidden screws behind, or well, I guess just above the HDMI ports, again, behind that sticker. Hopefully, with those two pulled out, should be able to just yank this out. Oh no, there's a bunch behind there too. You guys. Oh, it's only two more. Okay. Anything more back there? No. There, that just pops off nice and easy. What's on the back of the board here? Not too much. Couple of diodes over there, some capacitors, a couple little 8-pin devices, and whatever that guy is. One thing I'm noticing, though, whoever did the silkscreen on this board did a favor for future people trying to repair this thing. That is cool. I don't think I've ever seen somebody notate what all the unmarked capacitors are. And on the front side of the board, it actually specifies that the board is using 2-ounce copper. It doesn't make up for any of the other stuff, but it is pretty cool. Now let's get back to the reason that we're on this side of the board in the first place, to take that CPU cooler off so we can see what it is. Okay, that was kind of gooped down there. I'll pull that off because we don't need the fan on there anymore. There is an RF shielding can soldered on top of this processor. Right, well, that's annoying. Well, that was easier than I thought. Looks like it was just barely soldered in there. VIX Xcode 4210. Let's see if we can find that. Could not find a data sheet for that chip, but I did find a few press releases. It seems that this chip is specifically designed for set-top boxes, which is, of course, basically what this is. It's a multimedia processor system on chip. Looks like it can do some pretty cool things. It also does this kind of stuff. This I did not know. That's pretty cool. It's a Canadian company. Well, that is interesting. Who says we don't have high tech in this country? Or at least we used to have high tech in this country. Looks like it was a company between 500 and 1,000 people, but it got sold to an American company called Pixelworks back in 2017. That's kind of aside from the main focus of what we're doing, but I guess curiosity is part of this, so it's all fair game. So around this guy, there's four identical chips with that lengthy part number on them.
And those are all 2 gig DDR3 SD RAM, so 2.4.6 8 gig of RAM.
What else is interesting? Well, there's this analog devices branded chip beside all the analog inputs and outputs. ADV7842. Let's see if we can find that one.
Oh, despite it being analog devices brand, it's in fact an HDMI video processor. Okay. Oh, no, it looks like it is taking. Yeah, there's the YC, YPBR. Okay. RGB, a couple of HDMI connections. So it is doing analog to digital conversion or analog to HDMI conversion. All right. Audio output. It can even do SCART. It's not being used for that, of course, but it could if you wanted it to. Neat. And there is all the advertised features if you're interested.
Right. What else? What is this guy here? EP9432 or 1311G. Okay, let's look for that.
After a bunch of searching, I can't come up with it or anything with any of those numbers that make sense. It's definitely not a 14-pin dip.
Sometimes some of these parts are just harder to find than others. Let's see. What is this guy here? Delta Electronics LFE8505. Does that sound a bit power supply-ish?
Nope, guessed wrong. This is an Ethernet port filter. It's an inductive device. All right. Wait, I think I've seen this in some other devices before. This looks familiar. Anyway, that's what it is.
I've drawn a dead end in a few of these other chips, and a few of the other ones are just straight up. Like this one's just a CMOS logic chip, and others are kind of obscure. But this guy over here I did find, which is a Texas Instruments THS7347.
And that's an interesting chip too. It's a three-channel RGB HV video buffer chip. I2C control. It's got a 2-to-1 input mux, monitor or pass-through, input biases, all kinds of interesting video applications. It has three amplifiers inside it, presumably for RGB video. That makes sense. Applications in projectors, professional video systems, and LCD or DLP input buffering. Okay.
Well, there's some interesting stuff going on this board. Pretty cool. Not too much worthy of salvage other than the fan and where did that little Wi-Fi module go? Oh, I should see if I can look up that Wi-Fi module, see if I can use it, if it's a generic thing or if it's something that would be a real pain in the butt to use.
This is a single chip 802.11n certified Wi-Fi device, 2.4 and 5 gigahertz radios. That's cool. I was even able to find a manual for it. Yeah, but it also says that it needs their specific client utility, which concerns me a little bit about the reusability of this thing. And the only drivers I could find for it were Windows and older Windows. So maybe I can't reuse that as much as I thought I could.
Other than that, yeah, there's not too much salvageable in here. Once again, it's an interesting piece of hardware that is completely crippled by the shutdown of the cloud service that it relied on. I'm not sure where else to go with this thing other than just toss it into my box of circuit boards, which might have a connector harvested off them eventually. Maybe I'll grab the infrared LEDs off them, although I have several of those already. Yeah, I think it's probably just going to become a donor board for bits and pieces. I can't see any other use for this thing. Once again, another piece of interesting hardware that's been crippled by being locked to a private cloud that the company decided to shut down for their own reasons with no regard for their paying customers. Anyway, it was interesting looking at the hardware, I guess. Questions and comments down below. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.